afternoon this morning. Good morning, everyone. Let's try again. Good morning, everyone.
Hey, I'm Pastor Mike, and if you don't know me, so glad you are visiting with us here today. If you're visiting, or if you're coming back for the first time in a long time, well, hey, we just want to thank you for joining us, whether you've been here many times or only a few. Of course, you can find info about what's going on at the welcome wall and the bulletin board. We got coffee and drinks out there as well. And the good news, I'm always excited to share, is that there are a lot of things going on. Amen. Let me tell you about a few of them. Well, this Saturday, September 16th, the community pop-up is back in the front yard, planning on being outside from 11 to 4. So if that's something you like, feel free to support that. The last Sunday of this month coming up here, last Sunday, the 24th, is fall picnic time again. It is fall picnic time at the park. So at Seeley Carnegie Park, and there's a sign-up sheet at the foyer welcome wall. I've seen some of you sign it. Please do go ahead and sign that one. That will really help us out. We're looking forward to that after church, the last Sunday of this month. Hey, we also have the return of our Monday nights small groups starting back up again. And, wow, small groups are so important. If you want to learn more about the Monday night small group, please talk to Dan Begundo. Andrew, here comes Faith Promise. Can you believe it? Faith Promise, October 7th and 8th, coming up here. These are special Saturday and Sunday services with missionaries from New Zealand. And I just want to say, this is one you're not going to want to miss if you can help it. This is going to be a very special event, and we're looking forward to that. So, hey, for everything else going on, be sure to check the email news that goes out every week. Sorry about the tech issue this past week, but we should be back on schedule with that. Hey, let's get started in a word of prayer. Father God, we just come before you this morning and thank you for who you are, God. We thank you that that you are drawing us into your presence, Jesus, that you draw us to the Father. Thank you, Lord, for what you're at work doing even right now amongst us. Lord, how we've seen you set up and build a foundation for various things in our lives, and just seeing those come to fruition is a reason to praise. No matter what we're facing, you always give us a reason to praise you. Be with us as we turn together in this time of worship together. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen.
I'm Oh,
want you to pray with me. Father God, we just come before your presence in awe of who you are. And we thank you for your amazing grace. We thank you that that is abundantly given to us, just without measure, an amazing grace. We can't even wrap our minds around it, that you just would freely gift us your grace and love and salvation. So, Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for that. We ask and pray that you prepare our hearts just for this time of offering we're going to enter into. We pray that you bless the offering, you bless the gift and the giver. It's in Jesus' name we pray. God's people said, amen. I'll go ahead and call the ushers forward, if you will, and they'll come around with the offering plates.
Thank you.
don't you pray with me again? Father God, there's heavy hearts in here this morning, Lord God, and there are simply just burdens we haven't turned over to you in prayer, and that's the truth of it, Lord. Maybe it's because we want to run away from it. We don't want to pray about it. We don't want to think about it. Maybe it's just so tough. We see miracles when we carry it in prayer to you. So, Lord God, in this moment, Lord, if there's somebody with a heavy heart, with an issue they haven't prayed about, or maybe there's someone in their life they haven't prayed for, maybe someone who's just given them all kinds of stress and discomfort and just making life hard, and the first reaction is not to pray for them. Lord God, now is the time. Now is the time to do what you have taught us to do and to pray. Pray for our enemies. To pray for those who persecute us. So, Lord God, we want to carry our burdens to you. We want to carry our suffering to you. We want to pray for others and bring them to you in prayer. Lord God, as a family, heal the hurt that is among us. Among us, there is doubt. There is fear, there is worry and anxiety. Lord God, we ask that we carry these things to you as a family right now, to you in prayer. Lord God, amongst us, there is illness, there is injury, there is physical pain. We bring these to you as well, Lord God. We carry them to you in prayer. God, as a church, we pray for your special blessing upon us in these days and the ministry challenges we face and the opportunities that you provide us. We've seen a lot of those. We bring those to you in prayer. Father God, and as we reflect just around this time of year as a nation, we know that we're a nation who's hurting, a nation facing much confusion as well. We pray that as a nation you would bless us and that we would turn back to you. That we would pray in your name and do things in your name and fight for what is right and true. Lord God, overall, we pray for your many blessings to surround us and for your presence to comfort us, your presence to heal us, and your presence to guide us. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're at work doing even now and what you're going to do. We sang about it. We praise you for that. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen. Amen. Thank you, Grace. Good to see some new faces here at Praise and Worship this morning as well, right? That's always good. Thank you, everybody. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. And I just want to say, peace be with you. You know, this month, our focus is trusting Jesus through trials. As we just prayed about, you know, it's also a timely topic as we remember the attacks on our nation, September 11th. 2001. It's a timely topic as a nation because we face many new trials as well. And you know, the truth is, every day that goes by, despite these trials and struggles that we do face, well, that's just it, isn't it? Another day goes by. And we are given the gift of this present day to be that nation, a people who seeks the Lord first. In the times of trial, in the times when the sun is shining. We're going to look a little bit more at that today. We're going through John's Gospel. We've been looking at these moments when Jesus speaks a word about, you know, why we can trust him through trials, why we should, and how we can witness to that everywhere. Jesus makes these different I am statements throughout John's gospel. Last week, we encountered Jesus talking about being the bread of life. I am the bread of life in John chapter 6. Today, we find him talking about being the light. The light, not just to individuals or even our own country, but the light of the entire world. So we'll be starting in John chapter 9. John chapter 9, verse 1, and going through verse 12. Scripture says, as he, Jesus, went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus. But this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. I am in the world. I am the light of the world. After saying this, he stood on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. Then he told him, wash in the pool of Siloam. This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg? Some claimed that he was. Others said, no, he only looks like him. But he himself insisted, I am the man. How then were your eyes opened? They asked. He replied, the man they called Jesus made some mud, put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed. And then I could see. Where is this man? They asked him. I don't know, he said. The gospel of the Lord. Father God, as we have heard the words of this scripture this morning, Lord, may we just be attuned to what it is that you have to say to us through your word. Open our eyes. Open our eyes, God, to what it is you have for me personally, me in this church, me in Redtown, for all of us together. Wherever we come from, finding ourselves here on this gift of the present. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, amazing grace. What a beloved hymn. Amen. I love it. It's estimated Amazing Grace is sung 10 million times each year. It was written some 250 years ago. It continues to minister to so many, I think, because we can all relate to its lyrics. Going through life's toils, going through life's struggles and snares. And these words, I was lost and now I'm found, was blind and now I see. They capture that moment we experience when Jesus, he just opens our eyes to it all. He opens our eyes to what he has done. When we meet Jesus, a lot of things happen. He begins to show us this devastation of sin and the destruction that's caused in our own hearts, but also in all the world. And yet, he's forgiven. He's forgiven us. And in that moment, we begin to understand. We begin to see. We see the cross. The cross. Jesus died on that cross to bring God's light and his hope to everyone who might find him, to the entire world. Amazing grace. So going through our passage today, Jesus encounters this man. He's blind from birth. His disciples ask him first, Rabbi, who sinned? Excuse me? Who sinned? This man? Or his parents? And
Well, let me just say as a pastor that I hope I never get asked that question, right? Because there's a thing to ask. The question seems kind of callous, very rude by today's standards. And yet, you know, when you stop and think about it, Lord bless them, deep down, doesn't this question kind of speak volumes about us, though? You know, here we are with Jesus and kind of asking this because aren't we quick to kind of judge others, especially in the midst of their suffering? I don't want to say it, but it's true. Well, okay, consider this at least. When the disciples ask the question, they do address Jesus as rabbi, and that title rabbi is a title of respect. In Jesus' day, it meant not just a teacher, but also a community leader and a spiritual guide. So, consider this as well, disciples. Disciples, and that word means a student, a learner, someone who's learning from Jesus. And, okay, perhaps this question was asked rather innocently then. Maybe it's to learn why the world is the way it is. They really are genuinely kind of asking in that state of mind. But okay, whatever the case may be, well, there's still a problem here, actually. There is still a problem with this question. Because, yes, Jesus is the master teacher. However, we know he's far more than that. And in fact, they knew that too. They have been Jesus for some time by now. The disciples have seen Jesus do amazing miracles. You know, feeding the 5,000, walking on water. And furthermore, we saw last week, he's already made the first I am statement to specifically say, this is who I am. I am the bread of life. Later on in John chapter 8, before our passage, Jesus says, even before Abraham was born, I am. So you know what? In the midst of this question, they are missing who Jesus really is. They're missing it. He's not just a teacher. And, notice Jesus' response. And we saw this last time as well. Jesus does not dismiss them in their questioning. You know, he doesn't just outright, you know, dismiss them, let them go. And I think we can take this to heart. Hey, Jesus never dismisses us either. Amen? I don't know about you, but I ask God a lot of questions. Jesus never outright dismisses us. He does not give up on us, ever. He is not going to give up on you. I mean, this is the gospel. Jesus went all the way to the cross for us. We know he's not giving up. But neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus. But this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. Said Jesus, this is his answer for this question. And, thinking about this answer, it's kind of this equally kind of shocking answer, but for different reasons. Because now here we have the great I am. The I am is showing us who he really is. And because he is who he is, we can trust him. That's what this answer is beginning to get at. And we face a lot. The truth of it is that as a nation, we face a lot as well. One of the most mind-boggling things to me is just how tangled up it gets in life in this world. You know, when you think you've gotten ahead and you gained a little bit of ground and then something drags you back, we face a lot. There is so much wrong with this world. There is war. There is disease. There is natural disaster. There's things like torture and corruption. And it's ugly. It is vile. It is dirty. I don't know that we can even begin to understand the total depth of all the depravity and the darkness in the whole world. Well, classically stated by theology, it's known as the problem of evil. the problem of evil. The question is, if there's a good God who loves us all, why then is there so much evil in the world in my own life? Why is it all so messed up? Well, many of you are familiar, I think, with Lee Strobel and his book, The Case for Christ, later adapted into a film. In fact, once I had the privilege of seeing him speak in person. And if you're not familiar, Lee Strobel, well, he was an atheist. He was. And if you look into his early life and you're trying to find out why, this is a guy who, from his birth, from his very birth, remember that passage, Strobel was an unplanned and unwanted surprise for his father. And, talking about his relationship with his father, Strobel's quoted as saying, "I was always trying to achieve things to impress him and to earn his love, but I felt like I fell short." He told me he didn't have enough love for me to fill his little finger. And try as he might, Lee Strobel could never do enough to win his father's love. You know, I've often observed that people's unbelief, or even this, just hate towards the things of God, towards His church. Well, it nearly almost always circles back to this problem of evil. Because, you know, why is it? Why are some born blind or born with birth defects? Why are those even a thing? Why was Lee Strobel unloved by his father from birth? Jesus' answer. Neither this man nor his parents sinned. So right away we can see that personal sin is not the answer. Often in our trials, you know, of course, we wrestle with this idea, right? We're quick to think, I must have done something wrong, you know, to deserve this or that that's happening to me in my life. You know, that's why I'm hurt or even sick or, you know, or my children. Maybe it was not their sin or even mine, but it's, you know, like a generational sin. Jesus clearly states, our trials are not always a consequence of personal sin. Jesus said, this happens so the works of God might be displayed in him. And okay, I have to be careful here too, because how do we understand Jesus' words? Because upon first reading, we could misinterpret this to kind of say, you know, God did it. Right? But Jesus didn't say that either. Jesus doesn't say God afflicted the man with blindness or his condition, or today, any of our trials are simply like fated to happen. Like it's going to happen to you no matter what. It's not what Jesus is saying. And this is critical. In fact, there's a few Bible translations I appreciate to kind of draw out this point a little bit more. I'd like to show you from the New King James Version and KJV. That's the one that's trying to move away from the 1600s Shakespearean English. But that the works of God should be revealed in him. Revealed. Okay? Take a look at the NIT. This happens so the power of God could be seen in him. What does that say is that, you know, God smote him. So Jesus acknowledges, absolutely, yes, we suffer the harmful effects of sin. And some of those are going to be a direct consequence of our actions. However, you know, things like sickness, death, natural disasters, these things happen simply because sin exists in our world, period. Because Adam sinned, has this cosmic spiritual ripple effect. And sin entangles all people everywhere. In fact, all creation, the water, land, sky, animals, were caught in sin's web of death. The Bible says the whole creation has been groaning for freedom from the decay of sin revealed by Jesus and his gospel. Check out Romans chapter 8. And this is the answer. This is it. This is why Christians suffer. This is why those whose hearts are made pure in entire sanctification suffer. This is why bad things happen to good, godly people. You know, so if we find ourselves falling into that trap, I wonder if you could turn me down just a smidge. I keep peeking. If we find ourselves and we're always making those snap judgments on others, hey, we've fallen into sin. You know, if that's something that we're in the habit of doing and we're just quickly judging people, we got to seek prayer and repentance because somewhere along the way we become blind. But here's the part I like. Here's the good news. If Jesus makes this great I am statement, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. And Jesus says, He is the answer to death, suffering, sin. Jesus said, night is coming. Yeah. Even at the world's darkest moment, Jesus faced the cross. Jesus faced his own death for the sin of the world. But now, Jesus says, now is the time for light to shine, for God's work to be done, to be believed and received and applied. And you know, we're reminded of that first great I am statement. You know, when the Lord introduced himself to a burning bush so that his light and his warmth and his presence might draw us close to him and show us the way. Moses, you know, Moses must have wondered, what in the world was going on with the burning bush? Not going up in smoke. See the thing, God is drawing you in, even right now, personally, you, in a way that is, it's God has his hand on you, it's tailor-made for you, to be closer with him, to show you things, his presence, to sanctify you in that holy fire, whatever fits your situation and your trials and your struggles, it's personal. He cares about you and he loves you. So, really, it's only going to make the best sense to you. Because, you know what? The Lord does something strange in our passage. He spits on the ground and makes mud with the saliva in the man's eyes. Okay? And, hey, it's okay to wonder about this. If you've ever wondered what's going on here, you're not alone. Seems a little strange. What's the Lord up to? Hey, what Bible scholars will point to creation, the creation of humanity. In Genesis, we read about God created us from the dust of the earth, and he molded us like clay. It says, clay in the potter's hand. Job says later, remember that you molded me like clay. Will you now turn me to dust again? And so maybe this is what Jesus is up to here. This is heavenly. That we are the clay. God is the potter. You know, our creator. By making clay, Jesus is reenacting creation. Because remember, this is kind of a different miracle. This is a man born blind. So, he never possessed working eyes to begin with. So, rather than quote-unquote healing him, you know, I begin to view healing and healings in my experience as this is like new creation, actually. This is an act of creation happening. In this miracle, Jesus shows us who he really is. The light of the world, the creator, one with the Father. It's why we can trust him, even in our trials. This is the very creator of heaven and earth. He is the great I am. And this is, I mean, this is a huge takeaway, that Jesus himself makes new creation. even through the trials, Jesus undoes sin's damage. Yeah. And when we trust Jesus through trials, well, it begins to shine. It begins to shine for others to see. And that's so funny. I wanted to include that verse 12 in our passage today. You know, they ask him, you know, where is the man? And the healed man now says, well, I don't know. Just notice that. He's kind of become the scariest thing, you know, a miracle. It's like a burning bush. That we become these little burning bushes, this curiosity almost, this shining forth the light of Jesus. The glory of God begun to be revealed. And people are drawn to that. Where is he at? What is this all about? Our testimony. There are a few things more powerful than your testimony. Your testimony about God and what Jesus has done in your life and brought you through. God is using this to draw others to himself. And God has provided you that testimony of darkness to light. So I'd like to go back to Lee Strobel then for a moment. Lee Strobel, okay, after his father basically told him that he didn't love him, what do you do? What did he do? Well, he just kind of, he went career crazy. He just got so focused on work, work, work. And he never looked. He got a journalism degree. He got a law degree from Yale. He's very educated. He worked at the Chicago Tribune 14 years. And, you know, what he did was investigate facts, report facts for a living. He's no lightweight at it. And, you know, so he began to investigate. Come to this conclusion that we cannot know God. He's unknowable, therefore, God must not exist. Strobel's conclusion. He believed this very strongly. The majority, in his early life, until something happened. Until his wife found Jesus. This is when things began to change. When his wife began attending church and talking about Jesus, how Jesus saved her, he began to think, well, this is it. This marriage is going to be over now because I have a position that's incompatible here. Little did he realize what Jesus was about to do. He began to see that change in his life, a difference in how she treated people, how she cared. And Strobel, you know, being this logical guy he is, decided to use his training and investigatory learning and prowess to prove it all wrong. Prove God didn't exist, but the deeper he began to dig into the scientific and historical evidence, by the way, no other belief system comes close, the inescapable conclusion became, he's the Creator. Jesus is the Son of God, the Son of Father God, and this is proven. By the resurrection from the dead, and Jesus is going to a cross, to the cross for our sins to begin with. And you know what? He just had a moment of amazing grace. Jesus opened his eyes. He was blind, and he began to see. And you know what? Don't miss this part of it. He began to then testify to everybody around him about it. And the truth is, he may not have even recognized him. This is a totally new person. This is like a new person. Really struggle. I'm sure many have difficulty. They have difficulty in Jesus' day recognizing the formerly blind man. His name is Thursday, same day. Isn't this the same man he used to sit in bed? I don't know. He just looks like him. I'm the man. Let me testify what Jesus has done for me. Amen? You don't insist it. This change is really profound. When somebody becomes a new creation, the old is gone and the new is come. We can't take that for granted. We got to lose time. Amazing Grace. Let's see. The man who wrote Amazing Grace, John Newton, born in England, 1725. John Newton was his name. After being forced into military service as a young man, he was very confused. He was very lost. he was so lost and confused that he got involved in the Atlantic slave trade. Vile, despicable, evil trade. But then something happened. In 1748, there was this violent storm that arose out on the ocean, and it began to batter his boat so severely. You know, he cried out to God for mercy through the raging waves and the pounding rain. He thought his life was over. He cried out to God for help, and Jesus opened his eyes. Jesus opened his eyes to it all. He opened his eyes and he saved him. He saved him from shipwreck. He saved him from sin. And he saved him from a life of despair. And John Newton was never the same man. In fact, he began to study the Bible. In fact, God changed him so profoundly, he became an abolitionist, working to do away with the very slave trade he once helped. In 1773, he became an ordained minister. And, I like this part. He first wrote the words to Amazing Grace as a sermon illustration. My man. To express forgiveness and redemption, they are always possible, regardless of the sins you've committed. And no matter the storm you're going through, you know, you can be delivered from despair, from all the trials. This is why we sing God's Amazing Grace. That we too can cry out to God in our sickness and in our hurt, our tribulations and trials, our wretchedness, even our wickedness. The Bible says, because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, makes us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. Because Jesus died and rose again, he nailed our sin to the cross, the sin of the whole world, and carried it away with him forever. Amen? So I have to say, today, you know, hey, whether you are well-fed or hungry, or living in plenty, or living in want, whatever trial you face, hey, there is hope. There is hope for you. There is hope for your family, your children. There is hope for this country, this world. Our hope is alive. Our hope is great. The great I am is Jesus. He brings us God's light, God's love, God's fire for our eternity. Amen? We ought to draw closer to him. We got to do it today. And we got to let that shine to everybody we meet. You know, like the man born blind, he's here. The man right here. And I'm testifying to that. That it was me whom Jesus saved. Me. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, we come before you today. We've seen and heard about your amazing grace, Lord God. And we ask and pray that you would pour that out here. Pour that out in our hearts and in our lives, God. We ask and pray that you would open our eyes, that we would be aware of your presence, that when everything changes, that we don't just go back to the way things used to be, that we totally change our life as a result, not of my strength, but what you have done, Lord. Father God, we ask and pray for forgiveness. We ask and pray for the Lord that we would have a humility to be a constant learner, not to be somebody so proud that I've got it all figured out, I've got all the answers, let me assert myself. No, Lord, make us people who brag about you, who testify to your glory, who claim the amazing grace in Christ, capable of saving the wretched, the worst of the worst, the chief of sinners, Lord God. Maybe we'll just kind of cast off everything else that's getting in our way, whatever it may be. The saving face, trying to present well in society, or I don't know what it is, Lord, but there's things getting in the way of your gospel transformation in our hearts that it needs to be unleashed in amazing grace. We need to be testifying about you. So, Lord, affect that change in my heart, in our church. May we be that people who just really insists. We are the ones, Jesus, that you have chosen, that you have made new creations. We ask and pray these things in your awesome, mighty, powerful name, Jesus. And everyone said, Amen.
Thank you.